Hello and welcome to Market Guru. Joining me on the show today is Sameer Arora. Hi, Sameer. Always a pleasure talking to you. First question, how are you feeling about India right now?
Good morning. Well, surprisingly, I'm not feeling too bad about it, but maybe because I'm a born optimist and hopeful. But I must clarify that, you know, this is sort of, we are getting to the end game here. As in, the markets and us have all given too much, leeway to the government this year at least, in terms of first saying that in January, government will do something after UP elections, then in budget, then after budget, then in monsoon, then when the parliament session ends. And now it's sort of the end game where we are hoping that after the presidential elections are out of the way, that government will have a new FM, sooner than that. But that after that, they will do a few reforms, a few steps, which if I look at my old interviews and remember, I may have been thinking the same things 1 year ago also. But there is no point in being bearish today when the last round is being played. So we might as well be hopeful and hope that everything works out. But I think after this, let us say that they delayed by 2-3 months, I don't think there'll be any window left. And that would be deeply frustrating.
Where is the sense of optimism coming from, Sameer? I will go back to some of our previous interviews and some of the points you had raised back then, some of which have changed, most of which haven't changed the circumstances. But is the sense of optimism coming from the fact that you're probably seeing a bit more of action on the ground from the government, or at least an intent?
No, nothing yet. I think I'm also worried that today may be a bit of a disappointment because they've unnecessarily hyped some small steps that they may take today. We can't imagine that the finance minister who's resigning tomorrow is going to do some highly controversial things today. So today there is no intent and action that can be seen, except that the language, which actually has been same for the last many months, saying that we need to do reforms. This has come from PM, from FM, from Montek Singh, from Mr. Basu, everybody saying it. So in that sense, that intent was there. The only difference now is that if Trinamool Congress is a bit sidelined and frustrated, and if you found a new equation to get a president through, then in some sense the same equation should be used for other things also. It cannot be that all these equations were changed only to get your presidential candidate through. So right now I would think there is no action that has happened, except that the language has become stronger, and also because of pressure from rating agencies, from Reserve Bank of India, generally from weak currency, that since there is this window, there is an event, that event has led to some change of leadership at the top, that there is some hope that, now these things will be done. But it's still, it's hope, but it's sort of an educated guess by looking at the circumstances and the pressures, rather than actually that anything has been done yet.
So to put it more simply, your sense of optimism comes from the fact that perhaps the government is now finally with its back to the wall and has no escape route but to come out and do something.
That is one. And second is because of the presidential election, the TMC's influence has come down. And therefore, if again, we, as in the government, says that my allies are not agreeing, that would not be taken so easily by the world, because, one of these controversial or disruptive allies may or may not be there in a few months, or its role would be less influential. So therefore, it's everything. It's that there is no room for anything else. And because of a change of leadership, and because there'll be a new FM, and because if the prime minister's directly, even though the FM may be somebody else, once the prime minister directly comes into the picture, as in he has to answer questions every day on inflation and on IIP and on GDP, I think that pressure is very difficult to take every day, particularly by Dr. Singh, because he seems to react quicker if somebody directly accuses him of anything or charges him with anything or he's responsible for anything directly.
Mm-hmm. Sameer, one of the key concerns which a lot of global investors have now started to voice is the fact that this may not be a cyclical issue, but perhaps India's structural growth story in itself is under a question mark. I know you've been a great believer of the India story. Do you agree with that view?
I agree with it. And actually, if you see in the last 1 year, I've not been overly bullish on the market, except on the stock market once in a while based on where it is. But in general, that is what the reforms are needed for. The reforms are needed to prolong the structural story and to counter the cyclical slowdown. But clearly, right now, it is not cyclical as much as the worries are on the fact that what next? Because we haven't resolved any problems. See, one more positive, if you look at positives, the oil companies are not passing on the fact that oil has fallen even in rupee-adjusted terms. They are finding excuses to delay it, but that's all, you know, a new sort of tone or intent of the government. They are not blindly reducing oil prices, that is petrol prices, just because rupee weighted prices are less. They are making excuses here and there, but basically trying to keep the higher prices for the companies. So these are all small things they are doing, but they have to do bigger things. The good thing is that some of the bigger things are not so difficult to do. You know, we as in the government has made them to turn out to be so difficult. For example, about 2 weeks ago, in Delhi, the diesel prices were increased by 37 paisa. Okay, it was a small number, but it was increased by 37 paisa because of rolling back something. Nobody in the world realizes, nobody in even Delhi realized it, no press realized it, and it was taken. So even if you could do, small price increases, one rupee every month or something, nobody would react because nobody would know how to react to such small things. But you've seen it live that it was increased and nobody cared. It didn't even come in any headline anywhere. So there are ways of doing things. And then there is this hyper paranoia that if we do this, our government will fall. Government will not fall on all these things because there is no opposition which wants elections. Many coalition partners don't want elections. So it's all in the mind. And so that's the kind of hope, or if somebody is, you know, not as casual as me, he will say this is his great analysis.
Sameer, let's talk a little about where the market is. 2011 end, in fact, when we last spoke, it was early January, after which we saw a flurry of dollars rushing in. You know, we had corrected very sharply last year. Valuations looked attractive. Foreign investors came in. Today, when we speak, we're pretty much back to where we were as far as the market level is concerned. If you look at dollar term returns, we're pretty much right there where we were post these 5 months. How is, on the valuation front, from a stock picker's point of view, this market looking to you? Because again, there are some FIIs who we speak to who tell us that, okay, fine, yes, you've corrected back to those levels, but you know what? You're still 30% at a premium compared to some of the other markets, which have also corrected. So if you were to look at India, and again, from where money would flow and to where it would flow, how would you look at India at this point of time?
See, first thing is that foreigners have put $9 billion into the market this year. The market in rupee terms is up some 9-10%. So first of all, the domestic investors should not feel too bad about the market. It's up 8-10%. Last year in rupee terms, it fell about 20%. But before that, it was up 20%, and the year before it was up some 70%. So actually, I don't understand overly why the Indian rupee investor is feeling so sad in life. But from a foreign investor's point of view also, they put in 9 billion, and that is the proof of the pudding that India is, you know, it all depends on what scenarios we build. If our scenario is that we will have a rupee or a dollar run, or a rupee will weaken, and you know, or suddenly we'll be downgraded, all those things which at a stock market level you don't see, then we can't say. But from a micro angle, I don't think it is a market where you can't find good stocks, and that is why they are buying them in the first place, because ultimately foreigners have been net buyers by a big margin this year. So this is macro versus micro in my view. That if I want to draw negative view on India, it has to come from a big picture that oil will go up, that these two guys, that is Fitch and somebody, will downgrade us, and things like that, that our fiscal deficit will go out of control. If you look at pure stock market and don't worry about the macro, and you say this is the earnings growth of this company and this is what it's doing, and you have to assume a little bit about future interest rates and revival of investment, that doesn't look too bad. So in our case, it is quite a bit, if not 100%, 70, 80, 60% to do with ourselves, and only 30, 40% to do with Greece and Europe and everything else. So we can do it. And, you know, now let's see what yesterday the Prime Minister said in one of his whatever press conference or whatever he had meeting with the journalists, that he's finally realized that it is to do with us and we have to do better things or things in a better way, which is what everybody else has been saying. But it's good that our government people are saying it now. So, you know, you can draw both the scenarios. It depends on from where you start.
That's interesting you say that, because I remember last time we spoke, you said the Indian government could do with watching the King's speech and how to articulate. So probably they're beginning to articulate now.
Correct, correct. You know, actually, if you look at it, the Prime Minister, you know, who does not come to any, the Prime Minister does not respond to anything and people are frustrated with that. But as soon as somebody accuses him of personally responsible for something, he does react. When Anna Hazare accused the Prime Minister of, you know, corruption in coal, immediately there was a press release from the PMO's office. Immediately the law minister and the coal minister came on TV and started saying this and that and how it is not true. So the point is, he keeps silent only when you talk in general terms. But when you talk specific about him, he does react. And therefore, if he's on the line in this new scenario, even if the FM is his person, if the FM is a different politician altogether, then again it will not be positive, because it would not be viewed that it is a surrogate of Dr. Singh. So we want, in a sense, him or somebody who's clearly his choice, like, you know, Mr. Rangarajan or Montek Singh or anybody who's from his group. Then the world will look at it as if the PM is directly responsible, and therefore he will have to react to everything, and that is a difficult thing to do.
Let me come to the other point that you did talk briefly about.
In fact, I have one more idea before
sure,
that.
Sure, Samir.
Vivek, one more idea. My idea is that somehow we should make it compulsory for the Prime Minister to have a press conference every month when he's in power. When he's a Prime Minister, imagine every month asking the same questions to the PM. Imagine for 3 months you had asked him that, you know, the 2G rules have changed. Nobody could ever deny anything, because the press is so strong and people would give them all the questions they want. It should be not in Parliament, but as a press conference. I think that will solve 30% of India's problems.
Okay, Samir, that's a very good idea. I must totally endorse that. Let me come to the other point which you made when we last spoke. I remember that time, back in January, you said that the rupee could go all the way to 55. Now, of course, it went a little further than that, but you did make that point even back in Jan, and we came pretty close to that. What is your sense now? How critical? How critical? Because there are, again, some voices which say, look, you know what, somewhere I think this whole rupee fall is being exaggerated, because there are pockets of the market, important pockets of the market, which probably even stand to benefit from it. What's your own sense now on the rupee?
Even I'm quite, not optimistic is a strong word, but quite peaceful about it. In fact, I plan to, you know, remit a lot of dollars to India, which I had personally been deferring. In general, I feel that the currency in the short term can go anywhere. But, you know, even if I look at anybody's estimate, all the bearish guys who even feel that rupee was going to 58 and 60, at the end of the year, they have number which is in the 50s, 54, 53, 55. But in a big picture sense also, we can see it from two or three things. First is, of course, from gold. Second is from the fact that it has depreciated 25%. So on the, not on the margin, but in a significant way, must be impacting export versus import choices. And thirdly, oil is on the way down, or has been on the way down for the last 3-4 months or more. And therefore, whether the government passes through or not, the fact is, even in rupee terms, oil prices are down quite a bit. Now, you can say oil will go up again and all that is different. As of today, the trend is that A, it is lower than it was 3-6 months ago, and B, the trend seems to be that it's going down rather than going up. So, and from gold and all these, that I think that the rupee is okay in itself. But short-term negativity is more to do with the fact that also other currencies like Brazil and South Africa and all have been going down similarly. Even gold is down. So in terms of sense, this is a little bit to do with the US dollar strength, and then a rest to do with rupee weakness per se.
Mm.
But I am not feeling that if I were to invest in the market at this level, I would lose a lot on currency account from here on. If I look a little bit beyond, you know, 1 or 2 months, which who knows how the momentum works.
Mm. Sameer, when we last spoke, you talked about the fact that you had far lesser beta in your portfolio. You know, you were playing more the MNC game, you were playing more the banking financials, and you did mention that time that you didn't own metal, you didn't own infrastructure, you didn't own some of these oil and gas names, and therefore you were on a very low beta. Has that portfolio changed? Has that mix changed?
Well, you know, the longs, the general longs, we don't change so easily. But we have added a little bit of beta by buying in futures market a few names like State Bank, ICICI Bank, and L&T, and even adding a little bit to Tata Motors DVR. But on the margin, we are a low beta long. But on the other hand, what we've also done is remove some of the high beta shorts that we had. In some sense, we do some of that by removing some of the shorts, which are also very high beta. So in some sense, yes, at the portfolio level, our beta would be higher than it was at that time. And we are willing to add to it at any point of time. In the sense that we are marginally bullish and on the margin, we are bullish and on the margin, we are beta bullish. But our thesis is that we will not buy anything which we would not have bought 6 months ago, except that we were deferring it, delaying it, postponing it. So we will not buy metals because we anyway never buy them. And we will not buy real estate because we would never buy that. And we would normally not buy oil and gas because we would never buy it. So therefore, we have to play with some other names which are broadly acceptable, but which to us, but which, you know, at some point we didn't have, or because we thought markets were going down or something. But we won't change the basic core, that it starts from the stock and not from trying to buy beta.
Your two biggest themes that you articulated for the year at that point of time, and I want to understand if that has changed, was one, the whole MNC delisting play that you were looking at, and then you were looking at the entire banking and financial as a theme. Now, what I hear you saying is that you've continued to stick to it because you're still long on it. But there are concerns again there as far as the banking financial side is concerned of NPAs. Do you think that's exaggerated? Do you still believe in these stories at the prices they're coming in at? And what about the entire delisting players? Because that's something which would obviously be temporary, right? It would end at some time. So what's the theme now going into the next 6 months?
Yeah. Okay, so first is that on the financials, we have basically added to these names by not really selling anything and buying these 2-3 new names. Which currently are in futures only because we are not sure how it works out. But if the trend were to be a little bit established, we would move it to the cash market because we would like to hold it and not, you know, psychologically feel that it is only a trade. On delisting, two of them worked out very well for us. That is Alfa Laval, and there was one more, I forget which one. One more was there. But after that, it has sort of slowed down. And we are not adding to any names now, but we have 5-6 names together, maybe 9-10%. And the idea is that because we are sure from a macro that one or two of these names will not go through with the delisting, like it happened with one of these companies, Fresenius, whatever it's called, which we didn't own. But it obviously reminded us and everybody of the risk that one or two of these MNCs may finally decide that they would rather sell down than go up, than go to 100%. But at a big picture level, 3-4 of these 6-7 names, if they do, that's good enough for us. And the rest, okay, so we lose 10-20% on that day when they announce that they are not going through. But we have tried to be careful in the sense that we have only bought stocks where the current P's are not very high. Mostly they're in 20s, which is high, but it's not like 50 and 80. And secondly, some view on what the parents' view has been on delisting, whether they've tried it in the past, whether they have cash, whether they are generally acquisitive in nature and not too tight-fisted in life. But you know, out of 6 names, not every one of them will go through. But right now, I'm not adding because of you know, one or two of these guys, at least one guy sort of stepping back and, you know, we're not sure now which one is next and we want to overdo it. So we would rather today own steady compounders and not buy with new money something which we think can go up 50% if an event happens. Because if that event doesn't happen, we don't have the ability to take too much pain these days, where anyway currency loses us so much every day. Mm.
All right, Sameer, we leave it there. Thanks very much. It's always a pleasure talking to you. Thanks for taking time out and talking to us.
Thank you very much.